Fair warning, this story is going to be tough to listen to. It's a very sad story. But if this were to happen to me and my family, I would want people to know about it. So hopefully I can do it justice. But before we get into today's story, if you're a fan of the strange, dark, and mysterious delivered in story format, then you've come to the right place because that's all we do and we upload 3 or 4 times every week. So if that's of interest to you, please convince the like button to sing karaoke and give them a Rammstein song, but do not put the lyrics on the screen. Also, please subscribe to our channel and turn on all notifications so you don't miss any of our weekly uploads. All right, let's get into today's story. In 1996, 21-year-old Katie Fleming was studying French at the University of Oregon. That summer, she was invited to go on a camping trip with some very close friends and some people she had not met before. Their destination was this beautiful spot along the Sierra Nevada mountain range in California, but as soon as they got there, Katie did not take in any of the beautiful scenery. Instead, she fixated solely on 25-year-old James Kim, who was one of those people she had not met before that was going on this trip. And for the people that were on this trip, they would say James and Katie immediately just fell in love with each other. And for the duration of this trip, they were inseparable. And then when they got back from this trip, James would actually move from Seattle to Oregon to be with Katie. And then after Katie graduated from college, the two got married in Las Vegas and then settled in San Francisco. James, who loved technology and always had, was quickly hired by a tech company to try out new technology and then write a review for the average consumer. Basically, James got paid to play with toys, and so he loved his job. The couple also opened 2 boutique stores in San Francisco. One was an apothecary and the other sold eccentric clothing, and those 2 shops were managed by Katie full-time. By 2006, the Kim family had become very successful financially and they had grown in size. They had a 4-year-old daughter named Penelope and a 7-month-old daughter named Sabine. Katie and James both adored their kids. But James especially was known for blowing off virtually everything and anyone to be with his daughters. In fact, his friends and family would say you couldn't even have a conversation with James if his daughters were in the room because James would get distracted and just stare at his daughters and then would eventually just leave mid-conversation to go play with them. James was also known to bring his daughters to work virtually every chance he got, even if it really wasn't allowed at this company. On Friday, November 17th, James, Katie, and their 2 daughters loaded up into their station wagon and then drove north to Seattle. They planned on spending Thanksgiving with James's aunt and uncle who lived in the city. And also, James and Katie were considering leaving San Francisco and moving elsewhere, and Seattle seemed like a natural landing spot for them, so this trip served nicely as a chance to see family and to explore the area. And so late on Friday night, after a very long trip, they finally arrive in Seattle, and for the next couple of days, they have a wonderful time visiting with family and having Thanksgiving dinner. On Friday, November 24th, so a day after Thanksgiving, James, Katie, and their daughters loaded back up into the station wagon early in the morning. They said bye to James's aunt and uncle, and then they hit the road. But instead of just driving straight all the way to San Francisco, which would have taken the entire day and then some, they decided to make a stop in Portland, Oregon, where one of Katie's very close friends from college was going to meet them for lunch. And so after about 3.5-4 hours, they arrive in Portland, they meet Katie's friend, and they have this nice lunch, and then afterwards, the family retired to a hotel where they crashed for the night. The next morning, the plan was originally to just get in the car and then drive all the way back to San Francisco, but Katie suggested to James that instead of just driving all day, why don't we just stay here for part of the day, leave in the afternoon, and we'll stop somewhere between here and home. We'll break up the drive one more time. James thought it was a great idea. They pulled out the map, and Katie found a nice family-friendly vacation spot that was almost exactly halfway between where they were and home. It was called the 22 Ton Lodge, and it was located on the coast of Oregon in a town called Gold Beach. And so James and Katie think, perfect, this is exactly what we needed. Katie calls the lodge, and she makes reservations for that night. And so that afternoon, after the family spent their nice day in Portland, they hopped in the car, and they began traveling south towards the 22 Ton Lodge. At about 8:30 p.m., the family was still on the road making their way when James got really hungry and said, let's pull over and get a bite to eat. So the family pulls over at a Denny's restaurant in Central Oregon. They go inside, and then after a quick bite to eat, they get back out and they're on the road at 9 p.m. From the Denny's to the lodge was about a 2.5-hour drive. But after driving for 2 more hours, James realized they had missed a turn. So he told Katie about it, they looked at the map, and they realized if they were to backtrack all the way to that turn, it would add several more hours onto their trip. And so they began looking for an alternative path, and they found one. Instead of going all the way west to the coast and then all the way south to this lodge, which was the original plan, they could just go south from where they were all the way until they were parallel with this lodge. And then from there, they could just cut west along this road called Bear Camp Road. It would basically go straight to their destination. But what this map did not do a good job of explaining was just how dangerous Bear Camp Road was. It started at 900 feet of elevation, but very quickly went all the way up to 4,000 feet of elevation before it went over the backside of this mountain down to Gold Beach and where this lodge was. While the road is paved, it's incredibly narrow and it's basically cut into a mountainside, and so there's very steep drop-offs throughout most of this ride, and there are no guardrails protecting people from falling off. The summer is really the only time people should be on Bear Camp Road because that's when the road is maintained. In the winter, the road is not plowed, it's not maintained, and so even a light snowstorm could make the road totally impassable. And the road cuts through a very remote section of Oregon where there's just not many people around, so if you get in trouble out there, you're probably on your own. But the Kims were not aware of the dangers this road possessed, and so after going south for a while, they did turn on to Bear Camp Road and began slowly driving up the mountain. And so as James is driving, Katie falls asleep in the passenger seat, the girls fall asleep in back, and outside, it begins to snow. An hour later, Katie wakes up from her sleep, and the first thing she notices is outside, it is snowing so hard that James now has the windshield wipers on full blast, and still you could barely see out the front windshield. She looked at her husband, and he was hunched over, white-knuckling the steering wheel, looking intently out the window, and she says to him, you know, what's going on? Should we stop? Should we turn around? And James, without even looking at her, says, yeah, honey, I do want to turn around, but the road is so narrow, we can't. And then he would tell his wife that earlier, they had actually driven through a fork in the road where there was enough space to turn around, and so now he was just hopeful that there'd be another fork somewhere that would allow them to turn around. And so Katie was not excited about the idea, but she trusted James and said, okay, let's keep going. And so James just continues driving up this mountain pass, and you gotta understand, they are driving on basically a cliff. On the left side, left of James, is just a sheer drop-off, and the road is totally slick from the snow. And so periodically, as James is driving, even though he's only going about 5 miles an hour, he would begin to slip and slide, and he's right on the edge of this cliff. And so it was a very, very stressful ride, and after several more miles of this, they were not reaching any turnaround. In fact, they would have to periodically stop on inclines, put up the emergency brake, and one of them would have to get out and clear branches and rocks out of this tiny little road to continue onward. And so finally, Katie says to James, you gotta stop, you gotta back out of here. That's our only choice right now. And so James put the car in reverse and he opens his car door so he can look down at the edge of this cliff to make sure he doesn't accidentally veer off of it. And so very slowly, without even applying the gas, he began going in reverse, making sure he didn't go off the cliff. And for hours and hours they did this. This must have been so stressful. But finally, they make it to this fork in the road that James had seen much earlier, and they're able to make a decision. They had two paths they could take. They could turn around completely and drive nose out along the path they came in on all the way to the highway, but that was a very far drive and they knew that road was treacherous and there was a cliff drop off and it was really just as dangerous as what they had been on, and they really were not keen to be on that road considering the weather. Or they could turn left and go down the mountain on this path that was way wider than the paths they were on. It was like this huge road and it looked like it went straight to the bottom of the mountain. And they're thinking, we don't know where this goes. The signage is not clear where this goes, but you gotta figure if you're going lower in elevation, the weather will not be as bad. And maybe if you go down this road, there'll be houses or there'll be a gas station or there'll be something. But whatever it is, it's probably better than going that way or that way. And so James turned the car and began driving down this new road. Unfortunately, this was the worst choice they could have made. This road they were now on was this long, winding, dead end that was used by loggers in the summer. Now, normally, this mistake by the Kim family would have been caught because there was supposed to be a big yellow gate that sat across this road just a little ways past this fork, blocking all traffic from proceeding any further. But vandals had recently come up and cut the lock on this gate, swung it open, and then locked it open. So the gate is completely off the road. And so as the Kims drove past where they normally would have been stopped, they didn't even see a gate. There was no gate anywhere, and so they just kept on driving. And from where this gate should have been, the road went from paved to dirt and full of potholes, and it narrowed considerably. The couple drove for 15 miles on this very tight, winding road that once again was on a cliffside until finally they reached another fork in the road where they could either go right or they could go straight, but there was no sign telling them which way led to what. And so James stopped the car right in the middle of this intersection, and he and Katie look at each other and they know they're in trouble. So they get their phones out and they try calling for help, but they have no service. And so as they're struggling to place calls, one of them realizes it's no longer snowing. It's actually raining, and a lot of the snow on the ground seems to be getting washed away. And so after not being able to place calls for several minutes, they decide, you know what? It's 2 a.m, we're tired, let's sleep here, we'll leave the car running, it'll be nice and warm, and when we wake up in the morning, this rain will most likely have washed away the snow, and we can just drive out of here. And so the two are kind of relieved as they're saying this out loud, that this situation is not nearly as bad as it seems, we'll be just fine. And so Katie, James, their two daughters, they fall asleep with the car running, it's nice and warm, and when they wake up, Katie and James realize it's gotten much, much worse. At some point in the night, after they fell asleep, the temperature must have dropped again, and that rain became very heavy snow. And so all the water on the ground froze, and then almost a foot of snow fell on top of it. They were stuck. But Katie and James, they didn't panic because they remembered when they first turned onto Bear Camp Road, they had seen a plow truck parked off of the side of the road. And so to them, that meant if it snowed along Bear Camp Road, it would get plowed. And so that day, the Kims just stayed inside of their car and they ate snacks and they read books and they kept the heater on and they waited to be rescued. But over the course of that entire day, nobody came down that road. No plows, no anybody. And Katie and James continuously tried their cell phones to try to punch out and get some help, but they never had any service. Also, Katie and James continuously honked the horn in case someone was in the area that might hear them, but no one ever came to their rescue. And so by the end of that Sunday night, Katie and James were really starting to get worried because they have a 4-year-old and a 7-month-old. They cannot be out here for very much longer. But they began to tell each other that, you know what, it's Sunday. Maybe the plows don't come through on Sundays. Maybe they just don't work out here on Sundays. And so tomorrow, Monday, the plows will be out here. They'll come by and they will save us. Also, Katie and James began telling each other to reassure each other that, hey, tomorrow, Monday, that's the day we were supposed to be back in San Francisco, and so people are bound to notice our absence, and they will report it to police, and they will come out here, and they will save us. So tomorrow, we are gonna get found. And so Katie and James, they put their two daughters in their car seats, and James read them some bedtime stories, and then the family fell asleep. The next day, Monday, the family did a lot of the same things they did the day before. They sat in their car, they kept spirits high, they tried to use their cell phones, which didn't work, they honked their horns to get people's attention, that didn't work, they tried to ration their food, and the whole time, they're keeping their eyes up each side of this road they're on in hopes a plow comes through. But all day long, no trucks, no plows, nothing comes down this road. Meanwhile, back in San Francisco, the family's absence was noticed by a family friend, but they didn't report it to police because they figured the Kim family had just decided to stay out a little bit longer and they would be back soon. By Monday night, Katie and James were officially terrified. They were almost out of fuel in their car. They were almost out of food. In fact, to compensate for their low amount of food, Katie had begun not only breastfeeding her 7-month-old, but also began breastfeeding her 4-year-old. Also, outside of their car, bears began kind of assembling and checking them out. And at first, Katie and James would scream and yell and try to scare them off, but the bears ultimately were not that fazed by them. They were not aggressive, but it meant the family did not feel comfortable getting out of their car. And so they're in this very claustrophobic situation where they are literally trapped inside of this small car where all the windows are covered with snow and they can't go anywhere, they can't call anyone, they're running out of their supplies. I mean, this is a terrifying situation to be in. Katie and James had been really strong to this point, but around this time, they began to act scared, and their kids picked up on it, and they started acting scared and fearful. And so the parents were trying their best to calm them down and tell them everything's gonna be fine, and they're gonna get out of here soon. But in reality, Katie and James knew that if they didn't get found soon, they were probably gonna die. The next day when they woke up, which was Tuesday, again, no cars or trucks came down either road. There was no plows. The snow just continued to pile up, and the food was running unbelievably low to the point where James actually left the car and went out looking for bear droppings, because there's bears all over the place now, and he would pull the berries out of their droppings, and he and Katie began eating those. But after a while, they decided that was not a good idea because they might poison themselves. Their daughters, who the day before had been acting out of fear and anxiety, were now lethargic and quiet. And the parents' response to this was to start fighting with each other about whose fault this was, when in reality, they were just totally scared about what might happen to them. Meanwhile, back in San Francisco, the family had still not been reported to police. And so that night, Tuesday night, the Kim family once again huddled up inside of their car, James read the kids' books, and then they all fell asleep. The next morning, Wednesday, they ran out of gas for their car. And so they had no way to heat themselves. And so James got the spare tire out of the back of the car, and he rounded up some magazines inside of the car, and he lit a fire for the family to stand around and try to warm up by. And it worked, but the fire very quickly died out, and they couldn't find any wood that wasn't soaking wet to put on it. And so before long, they did not have a fire. And so all day that day, James and Katie were desperately looking up the road in hopes that a car or truck would come through. They never did. James and Katie tried their cell phones repeatedly, but they never got service. They honked their horns and they screamed out for help, but nobody heard them. And so before long, it was dark again, and the family was huddled up inside of their now freezing car, and all they could hear outside was the sounds of bears marching around the area. And so I'm sure James and Katie thought to themselves, I wonder if we'll survive the night. Meanwhile, back in San Francisco, that family friend who had noticed the Kims were gone on Monday, she did go to the police on Wednesday afternoon and reported them missing. And so a search party was being organized that night, but of course the Kim family would have no way of knowing that. The next morning, Thursday, the Kim family woke up, they survived the night, but at this point, James and Katie are speaking openly about the real possibility that they all might die. In fact, Katie says to James, "You have to promise me if our two kids die out here, you have to kill me too." And James said he would. At this point, Katie and James do not believe a truck or a car or anything is going to drive down this road and save them. They believe their only hope of being rescued is by sending a smoke signal up into the air that a pilot might see. So they pull off all four tires of their car, and then they pull everything out of the car that might burn, and they stack that on the tires, and that included Penelope's prized stuffed lamb. And then once they have their big pile, they lit it on fire, and fairly quickly, a large black billowing cloud of smoke was going straight up to the sky, and for a minute, the Kim family was very optimistic that they were about to be found, that certainly someone was going to see the smoke and come find them. But unfortunately, the fire burned out very quickly, they couldn't light it again, and nobody flew overhead. And so before long, the family is once again huddled inside of their freezing cold car that night. There's bears walking around outside. They're basically out of food. Their kids aren't even crying anymore. They're just silent and cold and miserable. And as they're all shivering and trying to stay warm, James realizes he needs to do something drastic or his family's going to die. And so the next morning, Friday, when they get up, James tells Katie that he had been studying the map and there is a town about 4 miles east called Galice that he believes he can get to in about 2 hours. Katie immediately said, "No, you cannot leave us. We need you here. There's probably a search party out there looking for us right now. We need to stay together so we can all be found." But James's instincts were telling him that no one was coming for them, or no one was going to actually find them in time, and so their only hope was if he ventured off and found help. And so Katie finally reluctantly agrees to let him go because he seemed really confident. And so at 7:45 a.m. that morning, James gave his two daughters a big hug and a kiss, told them he loved them and he would see them soon, and then he hugged his wife and said he loved her, and then he turned around and walked up the road out of sight. At the same time, unbeknownst to the Kim family, hundreds of searchers and helicopters are all over Bear Camp Road looking for them. 2 days later, on Sunday, December 3rd, so a week after the family had originally gotten stuck, a helicopter pilot that was part of the search effort was flying around Bear Camp Road when he noticed footprints in the snow below. When he started following these footprints, and eventually the footprints kind of disappeared under some trees, and then he couldn't pick them up again, and so without that much fuel left, he decided he would just backtrack and follow the footprints back to their origin. And so he retraced these footprints for quite a while until he came to a clearing, and in the middle of the clearing, appearing was a car, and next to the car was Katie waving an umbrella back and forth. The pilot immediately knew who he was looking at, but he didn't have enough fuel to actually land and pick her and her family up. And so instead, he just hovered down as low as he could, and he made good eye contact with her to reassure her that, "I see you, and we're coming for you." And then he marked on the map where they were. He flew off to the search headquarters, and just minutes later, another helicopter was spun up. They flew to that same location, and they were able to land in that clearing. And as soon as the pilot got out, he saw Katie running up to him, carrying her two daughters, who looked like they were in pretty good shape. And she's crying tears of joy, and she's thanking him profusely. And then when she's right up in front of him, she says, "You know, are you here because of my husband? Did James tell you where we were?" And the pilot looked visibly confused. Katie picked up on it, and she explained how just 2 days earlier, James had left to go to the town of Galice to get help, and he still hadn't come back yet. And so at this point, the pilot understood what was happening, and so he looked down and he said, "No, ma'am, we still have not found James." Katie was devastated, and she cried as she and her daughters were loaded into the helicopter and airlifted out of the forest and brought to a hospital. There they would make full recoveries. Meanwhile, the search effort, which had been all over Bear Camp Road, was suddenly focused exclusively on the area around where their car was. And professional trackers were brought in to look for James's tracks, and they found them fairly quickly and began following them. James, after departing his family to go look for help, which must have been the most difficult decision he had ever made in his entire life. He loved his family more than anything, and he had to abandon them in the middle of the wilderness with no food, with no power, and he has no idea if he'll ever see them again. And so after leaving them behind, he walked 3 miles up the road they came in on, and then instead of just continuing on that road in the direction of Galice, he deviated and walked off the road. He actually went straight down one of the cliffs until he hit a river. And it's believed that maybe he saw the river from up on the road and thought that would be a faster way to get to Galice. But either way, he got down to the river, and as he walked, he would leave behind him little bits of torn clothing and torn paper to create a trail of where he was going, presumably so if he needed to, he could backtrack to his family. And so he gets down to this river, and for several miles he walks downstream. And then after being gone for at least 2 hours and not reaching the town of Galice, he must have realized he had either gone the wrong way, and that's why he had not hit the town, or he had miscalculated the distance, and that's why he had not hit the town. But either way, he did not turn around and go back to his family. Instead, he pressed on, believing he was their only hope. And so on he went, crossing over rivers, getting totally soaked in frigid water. He went up and down mountains, all over these totally rugged areas in nothing but street clothes. He had sneakers, pants, and a jacket on. He had no food, he had no water, and he just kept on going until it was nightfall, and he had covered about 10 miles at this point, and he laid down and he went to sleep. And that night must have been absolutely horrible. As he thought about his family that was alone in the woods somewhere, he probably wondered if they were still alive. And the temperature was in the 30s, and again, he's just in street clothes. But he survives the night, and so the next morning, that Saturday, he gets up and he's right back at it, despite the fact that he was physically wrecked at this point. But for him, he didn't care. He was doing it for his family. And so all day he hiked in and out of freezing cold streams, up and down mountains, until finally he found himself at the bottom of this deep ravine next to a river where he just fell to his knees, fell forward, and died. He had literally just kept on going, looking for help for his family, until he eventually succumbed to hypothermia. James's body was located 2 days after his wife and his daughters were successfully rescued. It would turn out the town of Galice was not 4 miles away from the family's car, it was about 15 miles away, but that's from point A to point B on a map, like a straight line. But when you actually are hiking in the wilderness, you don't go in straight lines because there's mountains and there's rivers and there's things that get in the way. And so in order to get to Galice from where their car was, James would have had to travel 30 or 40 miles zigging and zagging up over 4 different mountains. And so this was a suicide mission from the start. James ultimately covered 16 miles through some of the most treacherous terrain in the country, wearing nothing but his street clothes. The professional trackers that followed this 16-mile trail to his body, they called his journey superhuman. The helicopter pilot would later say he never would have found Katie and the girls had he not spotted those footprints first and then traced them all the way back to that clearing. And it would turn out those footprints were made by James after he left his family and walked off to get help. And so even though it cost him his life, James did ultimately save his family. So that's gonna do it, guys. If you got something out of today's episode and you haven't done this already, please convince the like button to sing karaoke and then give them a Rammstein song, but don't put the lyrics up on the screen. Also, please subscribe to our channel and turn on all notifications so you don't miss any of our weekly 3 or 4 video uploads. We are now selling merchandise like flannels and hats and a whole bunch of stuff. You can buy it at shopmrballin.com. Also, go follow our shop's Instagram page called Shop Mr. Ballin. There you can find deals and upcoming promotions. If you want to get in touch with me, you can direct message me on Instagram or on Twitter. My username for both platforms is the same. It's JohnBallin416. I also have a ton of content over on TikTok where my username is Mr. Ballin. We also have a second YouTube channel called Mr. Ballin Shorts where we upload random short videos and lost episodes. If you have a story suggestion, please submit it to our subreddit just called Mr. Ballin. It's linked in the description below. So whether I see you on Instagram, Twitter, TikTok, Reddit, YouTube, or some combination, just know that I really appreciate your support. And until next time, that's going to do it. See ya.